We begin with the latest on the maritime tensions between the Philippines and China. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. refusing once more to invoke Manila's defense treaty with the U.S. after a Philippine vessel was damaged in a collision with a Chinese Coast Guard ship. That incident left four Filipino crewmen injured and has since drawn condemnation from the Philippines' allies. Marcos told reporters in Australia it is not a reason to invoke the 1951 treaty, which requires the U.S. to come to Manila's defense in the event of an armed attack. The president, though, said the incident was still of great concern.
We cannot view this in any way but in the most serious way. Once again, we will make our objections known and hope that we can continue to communicate to find a way so that such actions are no longer seen in the West Philippine Sea.
Marcos also calls this clear intrusion, the presence of two Chinese vessels in Benham Rise, supposedly conducting maritime research. His belief, this further escalates tensions between the two countries.
See it as absolutely unnecessary, because if it is truly a research vessel, then we could have come to a very simple agreement that the research vessel will ply the waters and do the research that they need to do. However, there is a suspicion that they are not only research vessels.
Still in the West Philippine Sea, China is also assailing a recently passed legislation that aims to declare the Philippines' rights and entitlements over maritime zones and underwater features. The Senate passed on third and final reading the Maritime Zones Bill last week. China's Ministry of Foreign Affairs has called the proposed bill an attempt to enforce what it claims an illegal arbitral award on the South China Sea. The Chinese side insists on their sovereignty over the Spratly Islands, including Bao de Masinloc, which is well within the Philippines' exclusive economic zone. Beijing also warns Manila to end actions that may escalate the maritime dispute between the two countries.
Australia also expressing concern following Manila and Beijing's recent maritime incident. Prime Minister Anthony Albanese cited the need for countries to abide by the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, or UNCLOS. Albanese earlier reaffirmed his government's commitment to strengthening maritime cooperation with Southeast Asia.
I am very concerned, and Australia is concerned, about any unsafe and destabilizing behavior in the South China Sea. It is dangerous, and it creates risks of miscalculation, which can then lead to escalation. So we would call upon a number of nations, emphasized in their statements, the foundation document is UNCLOS, the UN Convention of the Law of the Sea. That is something that should be the guide for all nations' participation.
A lawmaker raises the alarm on Chinese nationals with illegally acquired Philippine passports. According to Sirigao del Norte Representative Robert Ace Barbers, a Chinese mafia is behind the illicit practice. Authorities say the passports are used by Chinese nationals to put up businesses as fronts for their illegal activities and even acquire land. Barber said they uncovered the scheme during a panel hearing into the smuggling of more than 500 kilos of shabu, allegedly involving a certain Willie Ong, who is a Chinese national. The lawmaker said Ong was able to secure a passport and a driver's license. Barbers also says illegal drugs worth 3 billion pesos were shipped through the Subic port and delivered to Ong's warehouse in Pampanga. Here at home, the health department is ramping up preparations to mitigate any health-related effects of El Nino. Rafael Bosano joins us on the line for more. Raf?
Hi, Ron. It's not just the agriculture industry preparing for El Nino. Hospitals are also bracing for the effects of a strong climate phenomenon in terms of ensuring water supply, which is a resource essential to the daily operations of medical facilities. At the sidelines of the inauguration of the country's first urgent care and ambulatory service facility in Santo Tomas, Pampanga, Health Secretary Ted Herbosa said that he has also formed an El Nino task force within the agency to specifically oversee and guide health facilities during the climate phenomenon. Hospitals have been instructed to come up with their own preparedness plans to ensure water and electric supply are not interrupted. This, as many hospital procedures rely heavily on a steady flow of water. Jose Bilingan Memorial Hospital, which serves as Central Luzon's regional hospital, is among the many facilities gearing up for the anticipated effects of El Nino. With several water sources in place, it's not leaving anything to chance. It is also set up to additional elevated water tanks on top of its current water sources, which can store 695 cubic meters of water, good for 3 days. Aside from heat-related illnesses, the health chief also reminds the public to be wary of other diseases that may become prevalent during El Nino. Among these are water and vector-borne diseases. Vector-borne diseases like dengue are also common during El Nino, as the public stores water in open containers, which may serve as breeding sites for mosquitoes. Hospitals, according to Herbosa, have been advised to begin training personnel, particularly emergency medicine doctors, to better respond to various illnesses the public may experience at the height of the devastating effects of El Nino. Back to you, Ron.
Rafael Bosano with that story. Thanks, Raf.